रजिस्टर किधर है? A very warm morning and welcome to the revered guests, the principal and the faculty members, the IQAC coordinator in the one-day workshop on values and ethics being organized by the IQAC of the college. Well, every day working and responding to the pressing demands from the environment, both at home or at the workplace, we have got squeezed into being mere cogs in the machine. Often, feelings engulf us, asking for positive vibes in and around so that one is re-energized and rejuvenated. It is with this purpose we have gathered here to understand the relevance of values and ethics in higher education institutions as a key parameter of accreditation efforts as well. We are privileged to have Professor J.R. Sharma, CEO, founder of Accreditation Edge, amongst us as the resource person to share his expertise on the issue. I would request our principal, ma'am, Professor Lalima Singh, kindly accord a formal welcome to the guests and give momentum to the program. Over to you, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. Hope I'm audible, Jyoti.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
A very good morning to one and all. And a special and a very pleasant good morning to Professor J.R. Sharma ji. A very good morning and good wishes and greetings to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
From the faculty of SS Khanna Girls Degree College. The morning is really very good, and the reason is that today we have a distinguished academic who's well known, recognized regionally, nationally, internationally for his outreach in quality building and accreditation of higher education institutes. Faculty members, you know Professor J.R. Sharma, a professor of management studies, a former business head of engineering based MNC, a corporate lawyer at Delhi High Court. He has been counseling and helping various engineering, management and law specific universities and colleges in India. Apart from this, over 82 institutes of higher education in India, including BITS Pilani, have benefited from his service and his knowledge. He was invited by the National Board of Accreditation to speak at the World Summit on the relevance of global practices in accreditation in India, a summit attended by more than 1,200 Indian and foreign delegates from Washington. We are indeed honored to have you with us this morning, sir, in this webinar. The topic is of great relevance in this materialistic, in this so-called modern, in this so-called world of science and technology. Being a sociologist, sir, and I feel that the entire growth of the society, whether it is emotionally, whether it is socially, whether it is economically, and whether it is politically, depends on the values and ethics. And the core difference between ethics and values is that ethics is a set of moral principles, while values are standards of behavior. That is what we teach our students in sociology. And when we all were in school, we had a class of value education, and that class was supposed to be the most boring class. Oh my God, we are going to have a moral science class, a value education class, but none of us realize its importance, that the real threshold of the society lies on the values and ethics. I would not take much time, because we have a scholar of repute this morning who would be throwing light how important values and ethics are to one and all who is present here. You may be belonging to different stream, but you cannot work without following the path of values and imbibing ethics in your own life. Thank you, sir, for being with us. And over to Dr. Jyoti Bezzel. Please carry on. I would not take much time, because every minute and every second what word sir would be saying would be very important for all of us. Thank you, sir. Jyoti,
thank
can
you, ma'am.
On, please.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to share a quote from Gandhiji. Your belief become your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits. Your habits become your values. And your values become your destiny. Now I would invite Professor J.R. Sharma to give his, to take on the deliberation. Sir, over to you.
Respected Professor Verma Singh, Principal, ladies and gentlemen, I think what you said, the principal, I couldn't agree more than the importance that the values and ethics carry today, and all the more when you find that there's so much of a need for it. Ladies and gentlemen, firstly, I must say I'm so delighted to be speaking to very learned faculty of your college. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm of the very considered and a very sure view that yours is a good college for two reasons. One is that yours is the college which is multidisciplinary in nature and which has huge challenges when it comes to getting accredited. There are so many things, because I know it very well. It is very difficult to meet the requirement by all programs. And hence, the very fact that you are NAC A grade self speaks for the quality of education that you have in your college and the standards that you maintain. So I must congratulate you that you are doing excellent and you continue to be doing so and even better in the days to come. And second aspect is that you have chosen a subject which is very rare, and that is ethics and values in our teachers. In my good checkered career, I haven't yet seen any institution inviting me for this special talk on this so important an area where I think there is a huge need for knowing, and also not only knowing, but getting reinforced and get self-driven. And that shows that your priorities are right. And hence I'm so glad to be with you in this college. The only thing, why we need all of this, that's very important for us to understand. Because what we find, the society is quite low on ethics. As we are progressing and more people, the young generation joining, looking for a very speedy results, as well as various other very smart methods of doing things, which may not be in line with the values and ethics we have been learning for over many, many centuries. And it is very part of our culture. And that is one factor which is making it all the more essential. The second aspect of this is that the deterioration has taken place at the highest level. And from top down, if the deterioration passes down, obviously it affects everyone, be it education and be it any other sphere of activity that one undertakes in this world. And that's a very unfortunate part. So we need ethics, we need values, and we need to rejuvenate with our new vigor to get back to certain quality of life, which we and our young generation actually deserves. As said earlier, nothing would happen better and towards the right direction if we follow the route of the values and ethics. So this is as far as its importance is concerned. Now, I would wonder if I'm a right person to walk to talk with you on this values and ethics. So when I got... Yeah, there was some noise. Okay. So when I got this invitation, I was wondering if I'm the right person to deliver you this session. For because I always felt that it's so important that whatever person is, if a person is good enough, a person who is competent to deliver, his first quality of that person is to be ethical himself. So if he's not ethical, I think he has no right to be teaching ethical, anything about ethics and values. Today, it's almost a shame that so many people who are come in the garb of gurus sons and bapus, etc. They are all languishing in jails because they themselves could not follow this path. So similarly, you find a lot of politicians who have no qualms about values and ethics, at least during the election time, and they are around. But they talk of all ethics. So this, all of that scares, or scared me rather, before I accepted this. Now, interesting part is, and why I accepted to be, that I felt that I was perhaps very close to the walking the talk of ethics with you, for reason that my first background is the army. I'm an army veteran. So I have been to battle wars. I have been to most difficult areas. And in those areas, these challenges were so hard that the training of the army, which is full of ethics and values, where everything good is ingrained in you, like loyalty, sincerity, the truthfulness, the integrity, everything is packed into you full. And then with the bravery, you deliver on your mission. So not only this, every year you find there's a survey that carries on as which is the most ethical arm or ethical services. And army for years has been standing first in scope of ethics. So once they say, once an army man, always remains an army man, in spite wherever you go. So the ethic part, I thought, was very close to my heart. I tried to implement this when I went to industry. And the top level at a CEO's level of a multinational company, I ensured that the ethical and values are carried from wherever my roots were. And I would have succeeded, if not completely, but partly, in the company I served, or rather the companies I served. So after the industry, I joined education, and I was teaching IAS and IRS officers. Now, these were the people who also require a lot of ethics and values. And I wonder I was able to teach them because they learn from nobody. Anyway, I was with them for 2 years of teaching, senior guys, and I would have succeeded partly to make them aware of the need of values and ethics. Now, we are all searching for morality. And it's a very hard search. So what we find is that there's more wrong than good or right, and there's more evil than good, and there's more pap than punya. Morality is actually going rare. You know, when we were born, we were given the best brains than any of the species in the world. And God was very kind, and we should also be very thankful to God to have given us the path that by our being very intelligent with our brains, we will be able to reform, create a balance in this world, try to look after other species, try to look after nature, try to look after the have-nots, and make this world a far more livable. Well, that was what we can think of. And we had a lot of responsibility towards it. But what we find, that man is actually becoming most irresponsible, and hence so much of destruction, devastation, and violations of values and ethics is on the way. So there is an uneasy search, but the search must carry on. Or else, you know, our future of our generations will not be that safe. Now, from where does it start? Now, let me turn you towards the education. Be it NAC, be it NIRF, be it getting certain your college being recognized or any other inspection that happens, or anything. Unless the people at the top realize that values and ethics are so essential, and it must, anything that is done must reflect upon the same, we will always find it struggling. And you can see how stressful become the principals and the directors when only what they want is stated without knowing the realities on ground. And here the problem starts. So I think it's a very important thing to look at. Now, what is required to become an unethical person? This I thought yesterday when I was writing it, that it takes a little to become an unethical person. One has to simply kill the conscience, and everything then falls into place. Because anything which is very bad, anything which is actually immoral, anything which is harmful, comes to us very naturally, and it gives you a very short-term pleasure. However, the same is very injurious. These things also get reflected in our Vedas and in Gita. So, this is one of the things that we must be very careful, that don't go for expediency. Don't go for something which is just coming to you naturally and you run into it and later on you repent about it. Everything which is pious, everything which is good, everything which is, makes your life much better is very hard to come. It's not a random roll of luck. There are a lot of preservance which is required. And in that, if you don't have the right kind of mindset, you'll always land up into a wrong hands, and that is not something which we desire. I'll spend some time here. Now, our education system itself, where we are all there, we are in not the right kind of morality zone. And you are all aware of it. This is nothing very new. It's not a new knowledge. It's not a, no-brainer. But how sad, imagine. Like, for example, from the AICT, it's been going on for years and years, EU approval or other approvals. They expect a very hard standards by institutions, and institutions sign that they all have it. So their declaration is taken, and that declaration is all wrong. And institutions keep getting their approvals every year to run their courses from the AICT. Similarly, the inspections take place, and when they take place, who are the people who are inspecting you, and who are the people who are getting inspected? It all depends. Similarly, regulatory compliances, violations which are taking place are huge. You may not be in the know of it because your multidisciplinary probably does not touch that medical or medicines. There's so much of it in the medical colleges, medical universities, and deemed to be universities. It's horrifying. So, we are in a very uncomfortable morality zone. NAC and NIRF, you are all aware what institutes are doing. Similarly, research publications, how are they getting their publications done through a third agency who has no interest in you? They have employed some people and they get a research paper published on your behalf and on behalf of some faculty who don't even deserve to, who don't even can write two lines. So you get research paper. Most of the institutions which are looking for such very undeserving ranking or accreditation, they resort to it. And it's very sad, but good institutes won't do that. Similarly, for research and consultancy, the kind of projects which are moving in from the non-government agency is also very shocking. I know all of this because when I go to the various universities and colleges, I tell them, please don't do it. This is not the way the quality will proceed further. The awards from unscrupulous bodies and misleading students are, students, they start looking for which is good college, which is not a very good college. Unfortunately, they run into some award being given by some body which takes money and gives awards. And they probably fall into the prey of getting the admissions. How unfair, how criminal. Similarly, lack of financial transparency and profiteering. This is going on because they're not subject to any kind of audit, which is an audit from an agency which can pin them. The internal and external audit which the institutions carry out under closed door situations are the ones which are simply not acceptable. Goes to violation in admissions, norms, internal evaluation to make students pass, even if the student doesn't deserve to be passing. The stipends which are being given to some PhDs in mostly medical being shown as scholarships and whatnot. These are some of the things that, you know, which is sometimes, face to face look so horrible. But these are only very few of that. There's so much of a rot. So even if you have a new education policy coming in with such a wonderful ideas, these ideas will not get materialized unless the corruption gets out of the system or once the values and ethics are enshrined instead, and faculty and people at the top level are sensitized and they understand that there's no other way but the right way of doing. Let me also tell you that it's not only in India that this is rampant. There are other countries too, which are suffering from all of this. So it's not absolutely a new for India or India is the only one. But yes, because Indian institutions are far too many, something like 48,000 institutions in the country. And therefore, the control of these institutions, the governance of these institutions is extremely tough task. I had suggested to the government to create an agency like SEBI, which protects the interest of the shareholders. That why not students who are the biggest shareholders or number one shareholders, their interest be provided and a watchdog be created so that all those unethical, immoral, and things which are beyond the values and systems be eradicated. This suggestion had gone from me about 2 years ago to the minister, but nothing happened. Raise hand if you say no. I'll ask a few questions to you. Can you be a truly ethical and value person as teacher in your institute while at the same time not so ethical in conduct in your own home or with your friends and people you daily deal with? Yeah. So how many people think that they can be ethical in workplace, in your institutes, while not so at home? I don't think there would be many. So it is you know, you have to cultivate yourself, all these things in the personality that you develop, in the character that you have. It is only then you'll be able to reflect it everywhere. Even if you have the values and ethical aspects which are very clearly different than what your personal values would be, and then the ethical codes of conduct of the institutions are, they may not be same. But all the same, you will find that you will not be able to reflect upon as partly half for your workplace and partly a different half for the rest of your life. So try to inculcate certain things which you can, and your own people at home, your family, your children, everybody also takes you as somebody who's an ethical person. What is ethical to you could be an unethical to me. Is the statement right? I'll now explain to you, if you've given it a thought, see for yourself whether it is in sync with your thought. See, when you are working in a particular organization, the organization has its own ethical code of conduct. And those ethical codes, yeah, somebody asked me a question. No. What is ethical to you? So what happens is, suppose you're in an organization and there are ethical codes of that organization, then everybody sticks to those ethics. Then you can't say that because my values are different and therefore my ethical code should be aligned to my values. Similarly, in the areas of your interests in your universities and colleges, say for example, you are in the medical line, then your medical ethics will be applicable to all your faculty. So, whereas the values could be the one which help you grow and also reflect on your attitude and your work, and can be different, but the ethics in a particular environment shall have to be the same. Question 3, per se, it hurts me to be an unethical teacher, but seeing others around me, I do also fall in line as one in a flow. This is actually what is happening in most cases. It's not a question, but it's actually a statement. So what happens is we find there's a murky environment all around, and the whole environment is deluged with the unethical practices. You don't want to be seen an odd man out. You also start sailing in the same ground, on the same area. So that's what is called a line of least resistance. And that line of least resistance is something that generally people follow and fall into the trap of something which their heart doesn't say they should. Can you take the risk of being thrown out of a job while you don't budge in ethics or values, defying your organization? Your organization, somebody says do it a wrong thing. Should you be doing a wrong thing? Even at the cost of your job, I would leave it to you. But if you ask me, I would say, yes, I can throw my job and say, yes, I'll find my job if I'm worthy of it elsewhere. But I will not do something which is unethical. Now, this is something which is the most important thing for the faculty to understand. And reinforce within themselves. Once this starts coming in you, take it from me. You are on the right path. It requires courage. It requires conviction. It requires determination. It requires a great deal of boldness and standing on the right side of the fence. Now, let's say, what are the takeaways of today's small workshop? You must be wondering, how has it come so late as to what is the takeaway of this seminar? Because the first part is very essential for you to understand the importance and way situation is all around us and the way we have to wade through this difficult situation. And it is only then you can remove the chasm out of the current rod. So, is to become aware, firstly, of all facts of academic integrity, values and ethics as applied to a teacher, and draw lessons from them. I'll also quote some examples to you to encourage you to self-reinforce within each one of you an academic integrity, values and ethics. So I'll not be teaching you, but I'll be urging you to self-reinforce, because things only happen when there's self-reinforcing. At your level, when you are so wise, you are teaching to students, I cannot teach you. I can really teach you. It is self-reinforcement by you only, of your, and that will be the best thing to happen. And when do you do that? Again, it is you who have to decide it. So I think this workshop would open the eyes for some and make them a little more confident than they otherwise would be. And therefore, the need for them to go through the entire process of it. To recommend a mechanism for creating an enabling environment where values and ethics grow and blossom. It is for the organizations, so the management, it's for the principal and other people at the heads to create a mechanism for this. Like, for example, the IQAC. Very thoughtful of IQAC to have thought of this workshop. Suppose these workshops keep happening and they are delivered by people who are actually people of ethics. And then I'm sure this gets slowly but surely immersed in the faculty. Maybe not fully, maybe 80%, maybe 70%, maybe 50%, maybe even less for whatever. But it would do a great good to the faculty and great good to the society as such. I think it's worth doing. So create a mechanism within your own college whereby such workshop do take place, and whereby not just the workshop, but the activities and actions which are reflecting on these values and ethics. I have been always telling the people all around that these values and ethics cannot be taught in a closed rooms scenario. You have to push the person concerned to actually feel it and create a situation for him, a life situation, a situation with people, a situation where there is a learning, and that learning shall be a learning for life. But if you think it is an academic exercise, me and you sitting across the table and can go through it, sorry, it doesn't come through like that. You can't inculcate a personality in a person in a closed door scenes. You'll have to come out and put into practice. Make that person agitate about it. Make that person think about it. Make that person get into the doing with hands, serving with his shoulders to the wheels and pulling it. And then only he will realize what it is. For example, you are a manager in a company the best management practices would be taught in the floor shop, where you rub your shoulders with your employees, where you understand the pain of your employees, where you understand what would make their job much better, where you would try and find out what technology can ease the work ethos and make things better. And they also feel happy about it. So can that all be taught by sitting in a room, or even some manager or a leader thinking of giving all the instructions and orders to the shop floor, do this way, do that way, without dirtying his own hands? No. Similarly, you know, when I was teaching, I was giving one such lessons to the IAS officers at National Institute of Financial Management at Faridabad. I sent them into a number of villages and told them that you may have served these villages in your office by trying to alleviate their problems, trying to help them out, but you have never seen a real guy, a real person who's lying on the bed for years and he has family to support, and you will see it for yourself. They are not able to reach out to you for even a help. So once I went to enforce this thing to them, that they must be sensitized, because really these IAS officers would think of all that. There was so much of a rebellion among them. They were almost agitating and ringing up the finance minister, who was the chairman of that institute. Finance minister is always the chairman, you know, de facto chairman of NIFM. So they would ring up, oh my God, this professor who's come is making us go around for something which probably we could utilize our time for something else. But after 1 week of their outing to certain villages where they pitched up their tents and they ensured that they did something for those villages, they did so much for those villages after seeing those condition of the villages that when they came, some of them really cried on my shoulders. This is how you sensitize people. And I'm sure all of them are very thankful to the kind of exposure which was given to me, by me to them. They'll remember it for life. So these are the things, you know, when you teach your students as teachers, or you want to inculcate these things in you itself. So my dear teachers, please remember, put them into life situations, and then you see how they react to it. Something they would learn in this manner, they will never be able to forget in their lifetime. So let's come down to now academic integrity. This is something which is very essential today, and a lot of it importance has been given. I would request you to kindly have this promotion of academic integrity and prevention of plagiarism in higher education institution regulation 2018 read, if not read already. I'm sure yours is a good institute, good faculty, very high end, and the people with a lot of wisdom. And you would have read all of that. If you're good, if you're not, read it. Read it again, even if you have read it. So what is desired now by the regulatory authorities, by the commission, is that there is a need for intellectual honesty, and that is essential. They also have realized that people who are doing research, they're not aware of what kind of rigor they need to follow, rather than finding various easy methods of writing research papers or carrying out research projects as such. So there is a lot of thing which has come in writing in this regulation, and it's very good, which is why you would also find that even in a PhD scholars course, you have a subject which has been introduced on this academic integrity and prevention of plagiarism of values and ethics. And that is because the government is now aware that this is essential part and must be taken care of. Now, I was talking to you that if you are a college like what you are, and if you're not already set an academic integrity cell or panel, you better do that. So develop a policy and place it on a homepage of a website. I'm not going to ask you whether you have done it. Please see for yourself if you've done it and you have a policy in place, you put it on the website. In fact, you should put all the policies on the website for everybody, all of your faculty to have a look at it at any point of time. You can have it password protected for not people not to copy it down and put it in their own website or claim it as their own by doing a plagiarism. I remember once about 5 years back when I was in a university, I created about 60 policies. 30 policies were academic, 30 were of administrative, and prepared 2 manuals and put it on the website. And suddenly we found a lot of people copying it. And then the management said, no, sorry, let us have it protect the by password. So by then a lot of people had already copied. But once they copy it, you also know it, that anybody who copies it, you know that you can easily find out who's the first originator. So that was a saving grace, but then you must have it. So making policies, yours is a good college, you would have made policies. Even NAC expects you to make 22 policies. Now these policies, you must have your administration of your own college run through the policies, and policy must be made with the due consideration of all aspects and the future, and that it must be revised almost every year and given a revision number. So if your institute is being run by policies which are well made, or made with all the stakeholders joining their minds and hearts into it. It takes a lot of time, but it's a good work to be done. Similarly, this policy in particular, lest I should digress from my point, this policy must be put on a homepage and alongside the policy that you would have on research. So research ecosystem and rest of the research policies should be there, and this also should be there. Students undertaking and a faculty certificate on thesis, this is already a practice, this is just a point, upload on InfibNet, Shodhganga. This, I think you would have done it for your NAC. If you're not done it, please do it. Your all theses are supposed to be the repository of the and then there is a repository you must also make of the institute in which you should have all these theses uploaded. Then there is a plagiarism. I hope you have a good system of plagiarism identification, and you have a software which is not only a free shop, software, but a paid one that captures the part of plagiarized content. And that you are taking a notice of all the content, be it students, be it faculty, and identifying similarities up to what percentage. So minor similarities would be of no penalty. You must go through this regulation. I'm not mentioning the rest of the penalties before, what is there for 40%, 60%. Please go through. I'm not here to scare you all. It's only, I'm just in fact tickling your mind to read all of this stuff so that you are widely wise on what the regulations also say, not only what Professor Sharma says. Now, coming on to values, ethics, and moral values, you are all aware your principal has stated in very clear terms, and that's very great. I'm not going to deliberate on this because this is a subject you teach your students as well. As long as you are aware, the values are very fundamental in beliefs, and you know, it's something which guide your actions and make you a better person is something that you must be, you know, you must make it for yourself. You must make values firstly for your institute, for your college, and then you make write down the values for this for the teachers. So, and there should be a small booklet in which you have vision, missions, and values of the institute, and then the values of the teacher, so that it can be put in your pocket and this can be carried. I had prepared one long time ago, which was a pocket little book, a few pages, had everything for the faculty, and that was very, very good. When somebody came for inspection, they always carried about 10, 15 of those copies with them for their own institutes. So it's a good practice. I think it carries a lot of sense. Similarly, ethics also, you have to make, there are codes of ethics which are there, which are enshrined by UGC, and you will see for yourself that they need to be also adhered to. Similarly, moral values, you've been just told that ethics is basically an extension of the moral values, and it's not a teaching class today. It's keeping in mind that faculty of a very high standard that you're all, and I'm sure you'll go through it. Kindly read the UGC regulations on minimum qualification and appointment of teachers. At the end of first is a regulation you'll find the teacher's codes of ethical conduct. And that is something you should go through. Towards what is towards students, what is towards fellow faculty and staff, what towards organization, towards parents and guardians, towards society. I've combined some of these. When you go through, you'll find about 8-9 of them. I put it into 5, like combining organization with authorities and likewise. So this is, I'm not deliberating again, but my aim is also to draw your attention to this particular UGC regulation. I'll leave my PPT with you. Go through this PPT by yourself in your own time so that you can definitely see it in a far more detail than what I'm explaining to you. I will definitely deliberate on some of this, teachers' codes of ethical conduct and students. So recognize a student's right to dignity and expression of views. This is something I think we as teachers have a lot to travel in this area. I have been exposed to a number of universities abroad, and I found that this aspect is being taken care of very much as compared to what in India is. You know, gone are the days when we were treated as students like murga ban jao, tum ye kar jao, wo kar jao, and try to, you know, give a mass punishment to students make that person stand. And then some teacher would probably join the students in making fun of the student when students laugh at somebody. So these are some of those things which are all gone or should go away, because now it's a time of dignity of students to be very nicely safeguarded. The more you respect a student, the more he will respect you. Students in any case have become too sensitive, my dear. They are not ready to accept all kinds of nonsense from a teacher. And they are worldly wise also now, because the whole knowledge and the kind of various resources they have towards them, even not only resources, reading resources, not only synchronous, but asynchronous resources are with them. They can also call any faculty from anywhere in the world and can gain knowledge from them. So you are not now a typical teacher who will go and stand in front of the class and start teaching them on the board. No, you are a different teacher now. You've got to be inspiring them. You can only inspire them if you hold them in dignity and respect. Respect is something which is very, very essential, my dear friends. And make no mistake that these are the people. Well, they can go wrong. You can correct them, but you have to correct holding their dignity. I still remember there used to be one student who would come to the class, and it was a lock, college within the university. So that boy will always come. He'll come with skates and start rolling from one end to another on a skating all the way through. And making fun at everything, you know. So he was warned, he was told everything. And then he would do another funny thing, then he'll do another funny thing. So he came to a disciplinary committee and he was told. He did another funny thing in the disciplinary committee before the star and the rest of the thing. And he said, a law student, he says, "My lord, I'm not supposed to be hauled at. Wherein you have you impinge upon my dignity, and yes, you can punish me, but don't injure my dignity." So you know, it was such a jerk for most of the faculty to understand what he's. Secondly, you know, there is also an habit with us, most of the teachers, that when a student gets up in a class to express something which shut him down and cut him down, we try and say, "Oh, no, okay, fine." Because he has not created a good impression in the past, perhaps. So I think you must all mute yourself. There are a lot of people who are talking in between. I recommend to them to mute themselves. You will hear me better. Okay. So the expression of views and we must allow the students to express their views. Please, don't shut them down just like that. Listen to them. Even if they're not right and they're expressing what they want to express, have a lot of patience. Is one of the important values a teacher must inculcate himself in herself, that the patience must be there. It is worldwide recognized that teacher must be a patient. Must have a patience. Maintain own responsible pattern of conduct, probity, morality, and dignity. This is again something very, very essential. Now, often most of the teachers, get into all kinds of, aberrations. It's not very common, but there are aberrations. You must have seen it yourselves. A lot of aberrations take place. And in the conduct and morality and dignity. So maintain your own dignity. I have seen some, there was a faculty which was, charge sheeted in the university for taking his girl students outside for two domino pizzas after the class and not taking the boys along with them. And then he would just entertain them and come back. There was another person, very irresponsible guy, very responsible, that whenever he has something about legal teaching to be imparted, he would always bring an example where some sexuality is involved, that kind of a thing. It came to the light and he was called in. I was the person who was made in charge of the code of inquiry for him, and the inquiry was done and he was punished. He was removed. So you cannot, student, your teacher, your conduct, your character, your morality, your dignity will have to be above all, of a great standard. So that must be maintained at all costs. The other aspect is a deal justly and impartially. I think this is, I always found this was perhaps the most important of all. A student will get low in his life or her life if you are not treating her equal to other. There will be a lot of students who will come and please you. Hello, ma'am, how are you? I can do this for you. And tell me, what can I do? You go to the class, take attendance, do all kinds of things. Get some flowers on a birthday, present that, and become a very sweetie and good girl or a boy. And then, this is intrinsic in humans that such things are, such things are not stopped. But we take very good view of it because we are being heard, we are being talked about good. So whenever there is an assessment, we try to assess that person better than the other person, just because the person has been hanging around the teacher. So that's why, you know, if you would have seen this, you had a system of rubrics, which you also follow. I'm sure it's a good college, must be following that. So this is one place where you can rule out some partiality, but that's not the end of it. Still in rubrics, you'll be able to again try and put your own subjectivity into it. And therefore it's a caution to you that you have to stop within yourself and be strong enough and say, no, I will evaluate this person, whatever the person deserves. And regardless of diversity factors, be it of a different gender, different caste, different workplace, the place from where that person belongs to, whether of my community, somebody else's community, whether this, whether that, all verticals and horizontals are broken down into pieces and thrown away. And make sure that you become what you are, a total impartial person, a just person, a person who can be believed in. The day you have that, my dear friends, you will earn the kind of respect of your students. Even if a student is failing, he or she will never complain about you. But the day you side with some student and try, just because her face looks to you very pretty, her offerings to you attract you, if you start looking at all these extraneous and useless factors away from the meritocracy and away from the real worth of a person, you will actually be doing unethical practices. Next is recognize difference in capabilities, intelligence, attitude, and try realize personal, professional, national, and societal aspirations. See, the point is that no two people are equal, that you agree with me, right? And if you agree with me, people come with different capabilities. You know, there is something which a person inherits right from the birth. So the cognitive abilities of a person widely different than the others. How can you put everybody in the same place and think one person who is very good, oh, very well done, you are a nice, good girl. So-and-so, Supriya, you are excellent. Nobody is so good to you. And you start trying to pull another Sumita or somebody down just because she happened to have come with a different capability. Similarly, there are people with different attitudes. Some people will come with a very, very rude attitude because they have never seen a good attitude, or of their own parents. They themselves have been brought in certain environments. You will have to give everything to a grant to a student and then try and adopt their aspects that, okay, let me reform you. Realize personal, professional, national, societal aspiration is something you're looking at, nothing beyond that. A student has come and reposed all their faith in your institution and to you, my dear faculty. Can you disappoint them? Can you be led away by something which is extraneous in nature? You cannot. So it's your human touch and all of these. There's no algorithm that drives into this. So make sure that you make that person achieve for whatever the person's aspirations are there, and also have that person reflect upon the national societal aspirations. If you go through the national education policy, it has very clearly stated four different pillars of learning, a national education policy. One is student wants his own aspirations to be met in a particular way. He's got his love for something. He's got his own, he's passionate about something. He wants to do that or she wants to do that. Now, if you do not address that part of her or his professional longing for becoming what she wants to or he wants to become, you will not be a good teacher. You will have to walk some distance with her and make sure that she or he is helped out. Similarly, national goals, you have to sensitize that person to become a good citizen. A citizen is responsible and aware of the society and helping society, helping the downtrodden, helping the have-nots, helping those who are disadvantaged. If that kind of the ethos are not built, which actually reflects on ethics, then you will not be doing the right thing again. Similarly, for societal aspiration, the world needs something from a student, from me, from you, and that the world needs is that student must contribute towards the sustenance of this earth, the sustenance of its natural resources. The student must contribute towards the reduction of the carbon footprints. The student must also be one who's patriotic and able to contribute to the national concern security. And all of that stuff, and serve society in every conceivable and responsible way. You are a faculty, your work doesn't stop at student level itself. There is something that you need to do for the society. Have you, as a teacher, adopted one student, even from whatever class it is, from the poorest of our family, and said, okay, I can't support you with finances, but my dear, you will hereinafter will be supported by the education I can give you, guide you, or books I'll give it to you for doing that. If you're all sitting in silos, and you want also to be shown yourself as a good ethical person and a great person with values, sorry. If you're a person who's going on a roadside, see an accident taking place, and you turn your way to the other side, sorry, you are not there. You're simply not there with the society. So you have to be a conscious person all the time, doing something for, you've been born very special, I'm telling you. You're very special. I'm very special. So if we are special, then we've got to be doing very special things for the rest of the world, which is looking for assistance and help to stand. Because this world, what will happen? The world has been given to us so beautiful. This planet is just one planet in the whole world so far well known. And that cannot sustain, is actually going into a lot of spin for the kind of weather, the climate that is hitting it and hitting all of us. So similarly, all this consciousness will have to be awakened both in faculty and in students to make sure the students become very, very responsible people. So this was that, and this thing is held, okay? Now we have, let's now the cheers to ethical and morality. Okay, if all of that is so good, all ills, wrongs, and bad habits, I said, look very gratifying. They give a lot of comfort, they give a lot of joy, easy to develop, and have a short shelf life of pleasure. The route to truth is hard, but lifelong bliss. So make society livable. We all have a role to play. I think this statement is not just as a statement. It's something which must go deep down in your heart and make sure that you live up to the statement. I give you a small example. only 2 days back, I was the chief guest in one of the graduate ceremony of a very good college, A-plus college in Bangalore. And I met Dr. Pandurang Sethi, who was the president of the society, Rashtriya Siksha Samiti. And he really floored me completely. Old man of 89 years. And he tells me, Professor Sharma, I have one thing to share with you. I am very honest. Very few people will tell like this what I'm saying, that I am honest. I am actually very honest. He says, when I just about a few years back, I was told by the minister, education minister here in Bangalore, why don't you have a medical university or deemed to be university where medical courses are being run, and you are such a great engineering college, Army College of Engineering in Bangalore, perhaps one of the 10 top colleges of engineering in India, with more than 6,000 students, and what name you have, and now you are a university, but why don't you run your medical programs, which I allow you to do it? He said, no, sorry, sir, I will not run medical programs. He said, what? Why? He says, because there is so much of corruption. There is so much of wrong things which are being done. And I am unable to bear that out. I have my a dozen of institutions here in Bangalore. All are thriving on no profiteering at all. Not a single rupee saved in my name, in the name of the trust. How we live is on our other businesses. And by the grace of God, those businesses are also running very well, just because we are running an education business, which is non-for profit. All education all over the world is supposed to be not for profit. And we are actually not for profit. Can you believe it, Professor Sharma? I became emotional. I was just about touching his feet. Sir, how could you insulate yourself? He says, none of my colleges do that kind of a thing. I don't allow them to do. I only invest from whatever earning I get it from other business into this. I don't take a pie out of my education. And therefore, if I go into medical, I will have to do a lot of jiggery-puggery in this, which I'm not entitled, it goes against my grain. I'm 89-year-old. And I've been president of this samiti for last 45 years. I've earned my name. I will not go down this way. And why? Because, like, for example, in a PG, in a medical, you need a ratio of 1:3, one faculty for 3 students. And none of these medical colleges and universities have that, even 1:20. But they all show 1:3. How do they show? Because other faculty is a ghost faculty. So what do we do now? Can I get into this rot? No. Will the regulatory bodies change the regulations? I'm not sure. And so therefore, why should I go for it? So these are some of those very good examples. Don't think that everybody is a bad guy in this whole world. There are very good examples too. And I'm sharing with you. So it encourages all of you to go the right way. I hope so. Next is that it's God's own profession. You know, we are here to fulfill the divine purpose of the God. That's how important we are, my dear friends. So your real wealth is your students. Imagine when your students come for various, graduation day and alumni day and touch your feet. Not because you want them to touch your feet. Not that feet touching is something very solemn. in the today's world. Yes, it used to be. But the fact is, the kind of respect that person has for you, or the girl that has for you, is immense. You made her life, you made his life, and that should be a very big consolation for all of you. Similarly, you know, like army instructors, your own morality should be so high. When we are under training, and we find the army, when our instructors under training as an officers used to be those who were models, total models of their own units, who are warriors and who are very bold, very fit. And they would come and they would say, look, this is what we are. Are you going to be there one like me? And they will run with you. They will do anything with you, even at very, you know, senior age. You are very young, 20, 21 years, and they are 30, 35 years instructors. But they run with you. And they run for 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers, with all weapons and everything on them. So you always look forward to that, I'll go to the unit of this particular officer who's my instructor, because he happens to be my role model. So ladies and gentlemen, you got to be role models for your students. And then only you will earn the kind of respect. You are young, please do it, start doing it now. For everything, got to be a role model. Teaching, learning, role model. A role model for inspiring them, a role model for helping them learn good ethics, morality, a role model for them to make sure that you enable them to attain their aspirations of life, a true friend, and not somebody who doesn't know how to deal with students. Next is, when asked to do a wrong, remain steadfast. Show the way to the truth and honesty. Don't worry. You will definitely get another college, another thing, or another occupation to do it. You can maintain your path, but it requires guts. It requires a lot of self-reinforcement, self-belief, and then only it makes a difference. The mark of a superior person is that the person does not waver. And that must come to you as a very essential part of your learning. I end with, by talking to you, that remain anchored to the roots. Your roots are values and ethics. Your root is truth. Your root is honesty. And if your root is this, you'll be very happy. You'll sleep at night very nice. You'll remain anchored to the root. You'll build society. Somebody will learn from you, and somebody else will learn from the person who learned from you. You'll spread the fragrance of your good personality all around. And I wish you all, faculty members of this wonderful college that you are, led by a wonderful principal, who all, and IQAC team, who recognizes what is the worth of these values and ethics, and hence organize such a workshop for you, all the best in your life. Stay on course, stay good, and make sure that your presence is definitely filled by this world, and you actually leave this world as a catalyst of change. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. Sir, very dexterously outlined the difference between value and ethics in four contexts. As a person, what we should practice, then as a part of the organization that we are in, then our role as a teacher, and our role as a model for our students. Sir emphasized upon the values that we ought to be a conscious person all the time and doing the right things at the right time. We need to be very sensitive to the needs of our institutions, and that of the students as well. We should be impartial, going for expediency, but self-reinforce morality, self-belief, have patience, and maintain our dignity. Thank you, sir, for these invigorating words. Now I would call upon
the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Jyoti. My voice is not coming. Jyoti, my voice is not coming.
Yes, ma'am.
You're audible.
Thank you. Thank you so much. सबको नमस्कार. सदन लाल सावल दास खन्ना महिला महाविद्यालय की इंटरनल क्वालिटी एश्योरेंस सेल द्वारा वैल्यू एंड एथिक्स विषय पर आयोजित कार्यशाला में उपस्थित विषय विशेषज्ञ प्रोफेसर जी आर शर्मा जी, प्राचार्य प्रोफेसर लालिमा सिंह, उप प्राचार्य डॉक्टर नीजा सचदेव एवं अन्य समस्त प्रतिभागी शिक्षक वर्ग का मैं मंजरी शुक्ला हृदय से आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ, अभिनंदन करती हूँ. हमारा सौभाग्य है कि हमारे बीच विषय विशेषज्ञ के रूप में बहुआयामी व्यक्तित्व के धनी, राष्ट्रीय अंतर्राष्ट्रीय ख्याति लब्ध वक्ता प्रोफेसर जे आर शर्मा जी उपस्थित हैं, और उनके विविध अनुभव, विविध उदाहरण उनके वक्तव्य में हमको सुनने को मिले. जहां पर हमने जाना कि परिवर्तित परिस्थितियों में त्वरित परिणाम की इच्छा, आज की स्मार्ट कार्यशैली कहीं ना कहीं हमारे उच्च सांस्कृतिक मूल्यों को धूमिल कर रहे हैं, जिससे शिक्षक वर्ग और शैक्षिक परिदृश्य दोनों प्रभावित हो रहा है. अतः वैल्यू एंड एथिक्स पर कार्यशैली ही नहीं, कार्यशाला ही नहीं, बल्कि विविध गतिविधियां और सतत कार्यक्रम की आवश्यकता है. आपके उद्बोधन से हमने यह भी जाना कि नैतिकता का परिपालन प्रारंभ स्वयं से होता है. यदि व्यक्ति स्वयं नैतिक नहीं है, उसकी नैतिकता के प्रति आस्था नहीं है, तो उसे नैतिकता पर परामर्श करने का, नैतिकता पर विमर्श करने का और परामर्श देने का अधिकार भी नहीं. मूल्य और नैतिकता ही आधार है अनुकूल व सतत पर्यावरण निर्मित करने के, लोकतांत्रिक जीवन मूल्यों को बचाने के, व्यक्तिगत और संस्थागत प्रगति और गुणवत्ता के. और यह तभी संभव है जब मूल्य और नैतिकता शिक्षक वर्ग में व्यक्तित्व का अभिन्न अंग हो. यह नैतिकता आत्म आरोपित होनी चाहिए, जिसमें ईमानदारी, साहस, निर्भयता, सब कुछ छोड़ने के बाद भी सत्य के प्रति अडिग रहने का निश्चय होना चाहिए. छात्र छात्राओं की को अभिव्यक्ति की आजादी देते हुए परिवर्तित परिस्थितियों में कैसे हम स्टूडेंट्स की गरिमा और सम्मान को बचाते हुए उनकी नैतिकता के प्रति आस्था को दृढ़ करें, उनके आचरण को और अधिक नैतिक बनाएं, और कैसे राष्ट्रीय चुनौतियों को का सामना करने के लिए, उनका समाधान खोजने के लिए हम उन्हें निर्मित करें, यह हमारे लिए सबसे बड़ा कार्य होना चाहिए. और इसके लिए जिन मूल्यों की आवश्यकता है, वह हमारे व्यक्तित्व का अभिन्न अंग होना चाहिए, तभी हम उनके हृदय से सम्मान प्राप्त कर सकते. हम आपके मार्गदर्शन और उद्बोधन हेतु हृदय से कृतज्ञता ज्ञापित करते हैं. निश्चय है आपके उद्बोधन से समस्त शिक्षक वर्ग को मूल्य और नैतिकता के विरुद्ध मानकों को अपनाकर व्यक्तिगत और संस्थागत, अकादमिक और प्रशासनिक गतिविधियों की गुणवत्ता को विकसित और कार्यान्वित करने की प्रेरणा मिली. हम आपके आभारी हैं. आभार प्रकट कर रहा आपका हर शिक्षक मन, आभार प्रकट कर रहा आपका हर शिक्षक मन, आपके उद्बोधन से मिली प्रेरणा और उन्नत मार्गदर्शन। प्रोफेसर शर्मा, हम आपके हृदय से आभारी हैं और भविष्य में भी आपके मार्गदर्शन के आकांक्षी हैं और निश्चय ही हम आपसे समय समय पर मार्गदर्शन प्राप्त करते रहेंगे। मैं महाविद्यालय की प्राचार्य प्रोफेसर लालिमा सिंह के प्रति भी आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ। उनकी प्रेरणा, प्रोत्साहन और मार्गदर्शन के बिना इस प्रकार के कार्यक्रम का आयोजन संभव ही नहीं है। मैं महाविद्यालय के उपप्राचार्य डॉक्टर नीजा सचदेव, डीन स्टूडेंट वेलफेयर डॉक्टर दर्शनानंद गौड़ तथा अन्य प्रशासनिक अधिकारियों की तथा समस्त क्राइटेरियन इंचार्ज के प्रकोष्ठ में के विशेष आमंत्रित सदस्य के रूप में आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ, जिनके सहयोग से ही आयोजन हेतु अनुकूल वातावरण निर्मित होता है। मैं समस्त प्रतिभागी शिक्षक वर्ग के प्रति हृदय से धन्यवाद ज्ञापित करती हूँ। आपकी उपस्थिति और सहभागिता से ही विषय के प्रति न्याय संभव है। मैं आभारी हूँ कार्यशाला के आयोजन समिति के सदस्य डॉक्टर मीनू अग्रवाल, ऋतु जायसवाल, अर्चना ज्योति, डॉक्टर सीपी सिंह, डॉक्टर तनुश्री राय, डॉक्टर इखलाकुर रहमान, डॉक्टर रिया मुखर्जी, डॉक्टर सौम्या कृष्ण और डॉक्टर ज्योति बैजल की, जिनकी तत्परता और सक्रियता से ही कार्यक्रम आयोजन को वास्तविक धरातल मिला। मैं एक बार व्यावसायिक प्रतिबद्धता व शिक्षण मूल्यों को अपनी कार्यशैली को अधिक नैतिक बनाने का संकल्प लेते हुए एक बार पुनः सबका हृदय से आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ। आप सबका बहुत बहुत आभार।
डॉक्टर
ज्योति,
वीडियो
मैम, आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट प्रोफेसर लालिमा सिंह, आवर प्रिंसिपल मैम, शी विशेस टू एक्सप्रेस हर व्यूज बिफोर वी क्लोज डाउन। सो ओवर टू यू मैम। मैम काइंडली अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ।
कैन यू हियर मी नाउ?
यस
यस। इट वाज अ रियल ट्रीट लिसनिंग टू यू सर। ऑल व्हाट यू हैड सेड, एवरी सॉलिटरी वर्ड हैड अ वेरी डीप मीनिंग, बट द होमवर्क इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट सर, व्हिच यू हैव गिवन टू ऑल ऑफ अस। We all know what values are, and we all know what ethics is. We all know what we should do. But the path is very difficult, sir. But SS Khanna Girls Degree College, the faculty members, and me as head of the institution, sir, we'll try to follow all what you have delivered, shared with us your valuable views, both at personal level and professional level. It's a humble request to you, sir, that we would be requesting you very often to keep sharing your views apart from value and ethics, other than at the professional front also. All what you have shared, sir, we have noted. And next time when we'll be meeting, sir, I'm sure that most of us, the homework, the suggestions, the modifications, all which you have given, we will try to come up to the expectation and try that our college goes further to the academic heights. And I'm very thankful to God that I've got a committed faculty of SS Khanna Girls Degree College, and we'll be working on it, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. On behalf of my management, staff, and everyone, sir. Thank you, sir. Over to Jyoti.
Thank you, ma'am. Before the meeting is ended, I would request the faculty members to kindly switch on their videos so that we can have a photograph with sir.
Thank you to all. And once again, thank you to you, sir. We would be looking forward for more such deliberations from you. So thank you to all the faculty members for being with us in the workshop. I hope you would have all gained much from the perspective sir has given. Thank you.
Thank you, Jyoti. Thank you, Manjari Shukla. You've been excellent in your Hindi narration. And above all, my heartiest thanks to Professor Aliman Singh, the principal. I'll try. I'm already actually with some of your faculty on my routine blogs, which I write and keep sharing with them. And I do write quite frequently on my views. You are most welcome to be part of that. And look forward to see you in Allahabad sometime. I have plans to come. When I have plans to come, I'll definitely say hello to you in your maybe for 5-10 minutes, have a cup of tea with you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.